much. So now we start with the second segment of this Gynae Symposium at the 29th Annual International Conference on FamilyCon. And the first topic that will be discussed in this segment is going to be the role of zinc as a micronutrient. So initially, I will be discussing it. I am Dr. Maria IMRAN, and I am currently working as an assistant professor at King Edward Medical University. And I will be discussing with you the importance of zinc. And following that, our professor Ashish Chauhan is going to be discussing the rest of the topic. So before I start my talk, I would want to formally thank Professor Ashish Chauhan for giving me this opportunity to speak in front of such an illustrious audience, and also for arranging such an amazing conference and symposium today. And he has been really gracious for giving me this opportunity to talk here. Okay, so now I'll be discussing the nutrition first, and it is the intake of food, and it is considered in relation to the body's dietary needs. We divide the nutrition, it may be poor, and the effect is going to be that there will be reduced immunity, there will be increased susceptibility to disease, and there can be impairment of the physical and mental development. Also, good nutrition would mean that people are getting adequate diet, and it has to be balanced as well, which is also the cornerstone of having good health. I know the topic is really boring, but I would really appreciate if you would bear with me. Okay, so then there is the importance of nutrition in healthy development. And for that, since the baby is developing in the mother, so the mother's nutrition is really important, and that has to be stressed properly. And it is also influenced by her lifestyle as well as whatever dietary intake that she's taking. And as the development of the baby takes place, the nutritional requirements are also increased, and therefore the intake also has to be increased likewise. Then we have for the nutrient intake, we have various macronutrients and micronutrients. Macronutrients being those that are required in large quantities, and basically they are carbohydrates, proteins and fats. And micronutrients comprise of those that are required in small quantity, and they are water, vitamins and minerals. This is a pyramid that shows you what an ideal food intake would look like. We have at the base, as you can see, 9 servings of whole grains, and that is basically carbohydrates. And then above this, on the second tier, we have vegetables as well as water. And then at the third level, we have the proteins, which comprise of poultry and dairy products as well. And at the top, we have fruits. So if anyone is taking all of these nutrients in a day, that means they're taking them, it's a balanced diet, and they're taking them in adequate quantity. So now moving on to malnutrition, what exactly is malnutrition? It refers to deficiencies, excesses and imbalances in a person's intake of energy as well as nutrients. Every country in the world is at risk of developing malnutrition in one way or the other. And especially in Pakistan, it is underreported and under-discussed. And we are definitely at a very high risk. Nobody actually talks about it, but presently the government is finally talking about it, so maybe this problem is going to be finally addressed. So this shows you the global burden of malnutrition. This is a WHO slide, which is showing you that there is about 1.9 billion adults that are overweight presently, and of these overweight people, more than 600 million are obese. And on the other extreme, we have 264 million people who are in the reproductive age group, and the women are facing iron deficiency anemia. and then we have 462 million women who are underweight, and similarly the children are equally affected all over the world. So some of the key nutrients that we require in our daily diet are calcium, zinc, iron and folic acid. And in case of the deficiency of any of these nutrients, it predisposes the mothers to developing maternal complications, and in very severe cases even maternal death can take place. So the micronutrient deficiencies in Pakistan are really on the rise, and the zinc shows deficiency at the level of 48.3%. It is very hard to actually detect the zinc levels because in the body it is usually found bound to a nucleic acid or an enzyme, so therefore its level can be measured very discreetly. So, but still they have been able to calculate it, and that is at 48.3%. So what are the causes of zinc deficiency? Of course, reduced intake and reduced absorption are the main ones. And it may also be because of a diet which is rich in phytates, which are your legumes, beans, and people who are vegetarian, they also develop zinc deficiency because the absorption is affected because of the excessive intake of vegetables. And then people who have gastrointestinal diseases, for example Crohn's disease or ulcerative colitis, they also develop zinc deficiency. People who are alcoholics, because of the increased intake of alcohol, there is excessive loss of zinc, and therefore it has to be taken as a supplement. So why exactly is zinc important? Zinc is required for protein synthesis. It is required for cellular division, for many catalytic activities, and also for nucleic acid metabolism. So therefore, at every level of cell development, zinc is required. So it's a very, very important micronutrient. It is also required for the developing fetuses, for the normal growth and development. It also prevents congenital anomalies. It improves the general pregnancy outcome. For women who are pregnant, it prevents preterm delivery. It also prolongs the labor, and it also prevents postterm birth, and also gives you a cover of not having a low birth weight baby. The general features in zinc deficiency are growth retardation, loss of appetite, impaired immune function, delayed wound healing, hair loss, and delayed maturation. Also some eye and skin lesions. So zinc deficiency has a huge role on male fertility because it is part of spermatogenesis. It helps in the maintenance of sperm count and also of sperm motility. And its deficiency can definitely lead to impotency and hypogonadism in males. The zinc deficiency in women can, because it has a main role in embryogenesis, in conception and implantation. So therefore, it should definitely be prescribed in pregnancies, as it also prevents congenital anomalies, especially cleft lip and palate. Now the RDA, which is recommended daily allowance for males, is 11 milligrams and for females is 8 milligrams. You can see the stark differences between the two is because of the increased requirement in males for spermatogenesis. When women are pregnant or are lactating, the requirement is again increased, and it becomes 11 milligrams and 12 milligrams respectively. Of course, because of the increased requirement of the growing fetus. So the natural resources of zinc are oysters, them being the most abundant ones with zinc, but we don't have them in our staple diet, obviously. But we do have red meat and poultry. We have beans and nuts, whole grains, and certain seafood, including crabs and lobsters, and we have fortified cereals and dairy products. So, in conclusion, I would say that zinc has a very important role to play in our daily life should not be ignored. It can be increased, the intake can be increased by biofortification, which would mean that our food can be genetically engineered, or there can be fortification of the food that we are taking, or we can take it as a supplement, and an RDA, the RDA has to be followed, but we also have to avoid toxicity, that we should not take it in excess because that is also a problem. Now I would want to call upon Professor Ashu Chauhan to continue with this talk.
मेरा इसमें कोई लंबा चौड़ा इरादा नहीं है, आई जस्ट टेक वन मिनट. मैं आपको एक अहम बात बताना चाहता हूं जो इन स्लाइड्स में लिखा है कि जिंक एक इग्नोर्ड माइक्रोन्यूट्रिएंट है और जिंक डेफिशिएंसी इन पाकिस्तान आयरन डेफिशिएंसी से कम नहीं है. इट इज रादर in certain areas zinc deficiency is more prevalent than iron deficiency. Hence in normal pregnancy supplementation, or you know, whenever we talk about anemia, we must realize the best time to treat anemia is before embarking at pregnancy rather than during pregnancy. Jo khatoon store full ke saath jayegi pregnancy mein, usko pregnancy ke dauran anemia nahi hoga. और मेरा एक्सपीरियंस है जिंक के साथ, एज मारिया हैज सेड, कि इट प्रिवेंट्स आईयूजीआर, इट एनकरेजेस ऑनसेट ऑफ लेबर इन टाइम, इट एक्चुअली इज ए ट्रीटमेंट फॉर प्रिवेंटिंग प्रोलॉन्ग्ड प्रेगनेंसी. जो लोग ऑब्स्टेट्रिक्स डील करते हैं दे मस्ट रियलाइज कि हमारे यहां पेशेंट अगर ईडीडी से ऊपर चली जाए तो उसमें दो मसले हैं. एक मरीज के रिश्तेदार डिस्टर्ब हो जाते हैं और वो डॉक्टर को डिस्टर्ब कर देते हैं. दूसरा, अगर उस पेशेंट को मॉनिटरिंग की जरूरत हो तो उतनी हमारे पास मॉनिटरिंग एट होम नहीं है लोगों के लिए. और फिर जब पेशेंट प्रोलॉन्ग प्रेगनेंसी में आता है विद रिड्यूस्ड लाइकर, विद स्पॉन्टेनियस पैसेज ऑफ मकोनियम, और उनमें फीटल डिस्ट्रेस का इश्यू अपनी जगह पे आता है. इफ यू वॉन्ट योर पेशेंट टू डिलीवर इन टाइम, यू मस्ट इंश्योर दैट दे आर नॉट डेफिशियंट इन जिंक. दूसरी बात, मेरा सब्जेक्ट है इनफर्टिलिटी का, और इनफर्टिलिटी में मेरा पिछले 20 साल का एक्सपीरियंस है दैट द पेशेंट्स विद पुअर स्पर्म पैरामीटर्स रिस्पॉन्ड वेरी वेल टू जिंक थेरेपी. एंड इफ यू आर ट्रीटिंग इनफर्टिलिटी, द मेल मस्ट बी टेकिंग जिंक एज ए रेगुलर ट्रीटमेंट इन एडिशन टू फॉलिक एसिड इफ यू वॉन्ट टू हैव रिजल्ट आउट ऑफ दीज पेशेंट्स. दैट्स ऑल आई वॉन्ट टू से. आई विल गिव हैंड.